Okay, hello everybody, and welcome to Life from Beyond. Today we're gonna complete, hopefully, most likely, our the fifth session, fourth session of Into the Unknown, which is a Falling Stars using the Falling Stars system. We've luckily have had Chris McCallum and Paul Lell as our viewers for a few weeks in a row now, which are they're the creators and designers of the game of the system. And next week, Chris McCallum's actually going to join us for a little bit of a debriefing session where we talk about what we thought about Falling Stars, what we thought about the session itself, the campaign itself, kind of go from there. So join us, you can ask questions to the designer themselves. So we'll join us next week for that. But to kind of do a quick recap of what happened last week. Last week, our players threw their all of their tactical experience into the ring, and they were able to capture alive, so to say, the captain of the vessel of the Nettle itself, which is Randy Warren. They
Did we find out
managed.
If he named the nettle?
Not yet.
Okay.
We did not.
That's gonna be question number one.
And so essentially you find yourself in like a holding like a it's sort of like a, the main command center. There's a little bit of a holding cell there, and that's where you separated Randy Warren aside away from like his cronies that were there with him, and you're everybody get including the security officer, you sort of all gather in the same place, including the two people that came off of the steel, Lieutenant Commander Pittman, and his pilot, whose name currently escapes me. But they currently you all currently are gathered in this room, and this is, let me say, 10 minutes after where we left off last time, where where he was like, I surrender, take me off the ship, right? Because you guys like rolled in there with, I think there was a turret pounding away at, like 2 feet away from him. So when he realized it was pretty hopeless, he surrendered and you captured him. So, you drag him in, you throw him into the cell,
Should we do character
and
introductions before you get too far into this?
yeah, sure, if you want. Jeez. All right, fine. Kevin, Denver, you start off this time. You're
All right.
first.
Well, I am Kevin, and I'm playing Denver McAndrews. Or am I Denver McAndrews and I'm playing Kevin? It's really unclear at this point.
I thought it was McAndrews.
Yeah, McAndrews.
No,
That's the first.
it's not McAndrews.
McAndrews.
No, it's true. It's not McAndrews. It's McAndrews. Say
All
your own
right,
name,
all right.
damn right.
All right. My name is Kim. I'm playing Lieutenant Commander Lowell Mullen, the pronunciation of which is not in question.
Isn't it Mullen?
It is not.
My
That's
name is
definitely
Chris.
Mullen.
I am playing Ensign Perez.
Pierce.
Perez is how you
Isn't it
Pierce?
Crease?
pronounce it.
Pierce. I think it's Crease. No,
And it is Crease. That's in the old country.
Right. Okay.
In the old country. But we're not there anymore, Kevin, now are we?
Well,
Sorry.
the internet goes everywhere.
Mac Andrews.
Oh, it's my turn.
Yeah, it's your turn.
I thought you still had more to say.
I do mean I
Hello.
do, but I'm gracious.
Hello, I'm Nick. I'm playing Lieutenant Dorian Glass, and I'm feeling a bit disconnected. I feel like as hard as I fought in that fight, I didn't influence it in any way.
I think
You
we
know, I
established
gotta
last
get better.
session that it's pronounced Dorian.
Yep.
Right. All right, and before so Robin, before we introduce your character, why don't you tell
This is
us
a
about
mess.
yourself, and then we'll introduce your character.
Okay, well, I'm Robin, and solid start. Do I do, how much about my character should I say?
It
Why
wasn't
don't you introduce
necessary.
yourself first? Just, okay.
Well, I am an occasional guest here on the stream, but I'm a slightly more newbie RPG player. So, and I have not played on this module of Falling Stars yet before.
Okay, so as the group walks in and throws Warren into the ship, a you hear like a thump 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 through like really loud steps behind you, and a young lady walks in holding like a little pad, And Robin, this is your character. So why don't you tell us what's happening?
So what am I seeing in front of me?
So in front of you, it's essentially there's four people in Navy uniform, and the two that that you already know, they're there as well, including the security officer of the ship. You could tell because she has like all the uniform, and they're putting the what looks like from the records the captain of the cruise ship itself into the holding cell. So this is like what you walk into.
Okay, so I'm gonna walk up with I've got like a clipboard and a pad of paper in front of me, and I'm gonna say
it's a space clipboard.
Yeah. It's actually space paper.
Sorry, okay. My space clipboard and my space very important papers.
I look at them and say, I've never seen a paper before in my life.
It's clear that you've never RPG'd before.
I'm Ensign Iris Weiss. I'm here on direct orders from Admiral Monica Wilkerson, and someone needs to tell me right away what is going on around here.
I want to whisper to Commander Mullen, like, what the fuck is that?
So, at this point,
have I ever heard of a Commander Wilkinson?
So Admiral Wilkerson. Yeah. Admiral Wilkerson, she commands the Southern Fleet. She's actually like pretty up there. And she's like one of the eight or nine admirals in the fleet. And so immediately Pittman says, Iris, we were gonna return right back to the ship.
We throw this traitor out of the airlock.
The lieutenant commander that came with you.
Okay. The very excitable, very enthusiastic lieutenant commander that is apparently commanding your vessel.
Sorry, I'm distracted by how thoughtful
Lieutenant Dorian, get it together.
So it's a good look. Alright,
he's frozen.
I don't know.
Oh, it's gonna be one of those streams.
It's a much better freeze, though. We get like someone screenshot that, because that should be like his player.
We don't have to screenshot. We're recording the YouTube. Whole thing.
Oh. Even better.
Be like a frame per minute here.
This is like a photo booth.
This happens all the time. This is just an attraction of the stream at this point.
This is just Nick. It's actually just how he...
Yeah, if you talk to him in real life, it's actually like this.
But anyways, so that is your commanding officer, I assume, or at least the officer on your ship.
And what's
so that lieutenant? Ensign Weiss arrived on the ship that rendezvoused with the metal. With
that's
the
what
other
it seems
two
like.
People.
Yeah, it seems like she's so. It's a little weird because she has an ensign rank, but he's sort of deferring to her a little bit. It's like kind of weird because she's like, "Oh, we were gonna come right back, right?" Like kind of thing, and so that's like a little strange.
Okay, well, I'm pleased to hear that you're planning on returning. I don't know what the shenanigans you're up to are now, but I have new information on the location of Rose Willis, and we need to act immediately. So if you could just wrap up whatever you've got going on here, that would be great.
Say, perfectly fine. I sentence...
Pull out your gun and just shoot the captain.
I sentence Captain Warren to death for treason. Let the sentence commence.
Alright, I look to Edson Perez, who, I don't know. I assume as the least human, you're going to carry out the
I'm the doctor! I don't... What?
Sentence to death by shredding.
I'm the least likely.
The space Hippocratic Oath
actually,
is
you're
different
a space
than
doctor?
The Earth Hippocratic Oath.
So Megan Mitchell steps between you, and she's like, excuse me, I believe that this man should stand trial, and none of you look like judges to me.
Just stood trial.
I mean, he looks like a judge.
The military tribunal.
This is highly irregular.
It is highly irregular. There's a lot of highly irregular things going on this ship. Let me count the ways. Number one, no crew records. That's number one.
So let me get this straight. The scene opens with us on the deck of this ship, and we're about to have the actual conversation now.
Yeah.
Okay.
Look at the 10 minutes between us apprehending this guy and
you were just getting, like, Get you're carrying him, through the doorway, like he's lucky. Him on, like, you look,
eject him out of an airlock on the way up to the command center.
You're like busy slamming him against passing doors and stuff like that as you brought him.
Yeah, yeah, he's been a little roughed up.
Commander Mullen, have we resolved the issue of them being on a different ship than where we're supposed to be embarking?
See, that's the next thing you could explain, Ensign Weiss.
Okay.
We were told we were going to rendezvous with the Georgie.
I can't do that. I'm going to
straight cruise. She's laughing at Nick.
It's kind of like role-playing by, like, you know, like, you know, in basic training when they, like, firing the machine gun, you got to crawl into the barbed wire. That's what this is, like, our role version of that. And Chris is helping out, I guess.
It's role-playing within role-playing.
Chris, stop it.
So, I don't know what's going on with the captain, but, you know, if he's committed some sort of crime, like, I'm not sure where you think you are, but we have rules here. We have procedures, and the stability of our organization is based on following those procedures. So I don't know what's going on, but if this man has committed a crime, you need to get him in the brig. Is there a brig?
I'll remind you on the brig.
And we need to get on our way.
But it's a space brig.
You need to put him in the space brig, and we need to be on our way. I have time-sensitive information.
Let's see,
Denver's unconvinced.
You're lucky to be alive, Warren. And I turn to the security officer. Say, I'll trust you. I'll trust this man in your custody.
I mean, shouldn't we just take him with us or something? Like, this guy, there's nobody on this ship that has proven even, like, moderately competent at anything.
Well, on any of the ships.
We're here. So I'm here
just
with
as a clarification, what is the name of the ship that Robin came in on?
And the Steel.
The
name?
The Steel.
And we're okay, that's a much better name than Nettle.
And you're supposed to rendezvous with the Georgie.
With the Georgie.
We got to back up further than that. So
we do.
Well, we really do, because I'm confused also, because Alex, it was not made clear to me in what way you dealt with the lack of Lieutenant Dorian Glass last week. Was Lieutenant Dorian Glass like?
I think we did the standard, like, don't ask questions.
Yeah, I know, but sometimes.
No, there wasn't. It was
you were told to stay with the ship, and
you were off screen doing something important.
That's why I'm asking. If I was off screen, am I here?
Yes. Okay. You once given the message that they've been to meet in the command room. That's where you ended up going.
Okay, fine. Is the Steel the ship that the people came off of that were like, oh, we're here to your rendezvous?
We're here to pick you up. Yeah, that's the same ship that Robin and Lieutenant Commander Pittman are from.
But,
So, I can explain. I commandeered the Steel, and I'm here a little bit early, because I have new information about Rose Willis's location. She's actually, I've sort of pinged her location. I accessed some databases and was able to pin her down, and she's a lot closer than originally thought. She's about 2 hours away.
Can you tell me what the kinds of databases you access?
Absolutely not. They're highly classified, and you don't have access to them.
Oh, I probably do.
Well,
you sure should.
Not sanctioned.
I should.
After this excavate.
Not sanctioned
access. Make a note in my space pad.
Oh, all right.
Space pad.
I hack into her space pad.
It's just paper.
It's a piece of
paper.
Whoa!
Wait. That blows my mind. Is it a piece of paper?
You keep trying.
It's just a book. The
encryption of this paper is mind-blowing. I can't handle that.
Anyway, I commandeered the Steel in order to rendezvous with you earlier. I'm sure this is
the Steel? You were just like, take me to this place. And they're like, all right.
Listen, I'm under direct orders to find Rose Willis. I have new information. I was told that you guys were a together bunch of people that could help me, which is why
we are a together bunch of people.
On my super secret database, it listed you guys as not a total wreck. But
okay, well, I just want to point out that, like, in relationship to the background of the people that we are interacting with, we are, you know, extremely competent.
Excellent. If you prove it, get yourself together and let's get on our way.
No, not in the objective sense. Just,
the real question is: has anybody on the Nettle or the Steel successfully circumnavigated the nebula? Because, like, I will know not if they're confident all. Or not.
We're not even going to get into that. All right, I say, finance and vice, let's get on the way. And I I shove Warren down to the ground in the cell.
But I think we should take him with us. Why? If we have any kind of handcuffs, we can just stick him in I don't know, the bathroom. Pittman,
why are we going anywhere at all? I thought we were on vacation.
Pittman looks at McAndrew and says, this young man is absolutely correct. He says, I was shot at because of him. We're not just going to leave him here. We're taking him straight to the tribunal.
I'm not taking him anywhere. We're going to have a tribunal right now. We're leaving him here.
My God. Can we just hold a tribunal right now? All right.
I already passed a sentence, I feel like we're pretty much order. Done with the tribunal.
I believe he has a right to a space lawyer.
I think
they call them
space
lawyers at this point.
Attorney.
Isn't there some dystopian future? Are we sure that the right to representation still exists?
Well, I think in the dystopian future, it's actually just nothing but lawyers. So that's really
thanks, Dorian.
And so Pittman looks at at Commander Mullen, and he says, "You have two more, don't you, Foster and Pena?"
They're dead.
And if they're not, we'll kill them so that it's convenient.
Wait, I'm sorry. Who said that to who?
Pittman says that to Commander Mullen, to Kim's character.
Oh, this is the thing. This is like one of the messed up things. Like the transport that arrived thought we had more people than we did.
Right.
I'm sorry.
No.
What do you mean more people?
Your records must be wrong.
The ship that you commandeered, that you're in charge of right now, potentially.
Pittman walks over to Iris and he points somewhere on your paper pad and flips through and he's like, "Not here. We're supposed to pick up 7."
Yeah,
right?
I've got Pena and tell me the name again.
Foster.
Foster, yeah. Pena and this they didn't give me any information about, but is there a Cerulean here?
There's three on the ship. I mean, does it look like there's a fucking Cerulean here?
So not just in this as room. McAndrew says that, a very tall Cerulean walks into the.
Like I said,
it's a cat.
Obviously, does look like there's a Cerulean.
And he sort of bows to you, and he walks over to Iris, and he just kind of does a little wave, and he hands you a little document, a little e-document that. Has his name and papers on it and stuff.
It's unpronounceable.
Is he in a navy uniform? Mr.
What's his name?
It's not pronounceable. Just Cerulean.
Is this Pena?
No.
So it's Foster.
They're supposed to be Foster. They're supposed to be Pena, and they're supposed to be a Cerulean.
Yeah.
So his name is Zarin.
Zarin?
It's a little hard to pronounce.
Mr. Zarin? All right.
It's Zarin.
Zarin, are you supposed to come with me?
And he nods his head.
They have heads?
Great. Well,
yeah, since there's a Cerulean in front of us, why don't you describe what they look like?
All right. So if I was to, just take a guess, they look something like that.
Oh my God.
So
that's totally inaccurate. That's so outdated.
Very accurate. So he stands in front of you. He's not doing a lot of talking. But he sort of when Iris asks him whether he's supposed to come with you, he sort of just does a one-time nod and stands aside.
So my feeling is a couple of people from the cruise ship died. We're missing a couple of people. It's pretty 50-50 whether we just balance out the cruise ship's manifest or our manifest. I don't really want to go looking for these people. Let's just leave the same number of people that were supposed to be on the cruise ship.
Might understand that Foster and Pena are nowhere on board.
Well, we have no idea.
Okay, hold on.
They've never been on our mission.
Wait. You said that there's two extra people.
This paperwork is totally wrong, and that's
and one of them is a Cerulean, but one they're named Foster and Pena.
No, I'm here to pick up three people.
Oh, one of them's Cerulean, one of them's Foster, one's Pena. Okay, sorry.
So Pittman looks.
What do they?
I regret have... that I was not given more information on this Aurelian. I find the lack of detail.
Oh well, we could research it. Watch. Hey Zarin, what's up with you?
So
great.
So Pittman looks. He's like, he says your team should have consisted of, and he looks down. He's like six or seven people, right?
He's like, six or seven.
See, your information is wrong, Pittman. You're out of your element.
So he's like, all right, well, let's get out of here then.
Wait a minute. So you and some ensign come in here name-dropping an admiral saying all kinds of wrong information. You just expect us to hop in a ship that we're not expecting and come with you? This is all highly irregular.
This is highly irregular. Yeah, this is highly irregular. You're highly irregular.
It's reasonably irregular.
Calm down.
I mean, I'm just giving you updates on the orders that these people should already have. I don't know why I'm missing members of my team. But...
He hands you over like his documents, right? Like the Pittman's documents.
He hands them to me?
To Kim.
I'll hand them to McAndrews. I say, Ensign, verify the authenticity of these.
Alright, why don't you verify them?
Looks like paper to me.
Oh, I will try to verify them.
Do it.
It's like written in like old-timey script.
Right. Well, yeah, I mean, I will just scan them into my, you know, computer self with my vision eye, computer eye. I'm not dealing with this goddamn fiber-based communications ridiculous bullshit.
You should, like, rip it up as soon as you do that.
Oh, yeah, I will pull out my gun and shoot a hole through it.
All right, you've cracked the hull of the ship. We're all going to die. All
right, I'm gonna roll.
Okay. So,
oh, what am I rolling?
Oh,
rolling your computer use. Right?
What is he rolling for?
He's making sure
uploading these documents and then the authenticating.
But what skill am I rolling? Is really my question.
Computer use, he said.
Computer use.
Oh, okay.
So verify that it's, you know. All right. So it looks like exactly how the Navy kind of hands out their like missives and like missions and stuff like that. So you know, you like a brief glance shows that the Steel was heading over to some unnavigable nebula, but last minute they got a hail from Iris, who told them that, you know, there's a mission that holds a higher priority. And that had like an admiral stamp of approval, and so essentially their ship was told to come meet you here instead, and pick you up.
Like, I can verify the documents are legit.
From what you can tell, this is like as legit as it gets, right? Like this was all done through the proper channels.
Okay, so
these papers are fake, Commander.
So I want to ask something. So first of all, what was the ship we were supposed to meet in like three more days?
The Georgie.
Okay, and am I crazy? Like, isn't it? Can't we just like send a message to the admiral's office and be like, "Hey, should we get on the Steel instead of waiting for the Georgie?" I don't understand.
If they're correct, if they have like the proper authorization codes or whatever, then I can't do anything other than trust them.
I mean, I disagree. We maybe not be able to do anything other than go with them. We certainly don't have to trust them.
Either way, we should get a move on.
Listen, Rose Willis is only about 2 hours away. How about we go do the mission like we're supposed to, and then we get back, you can fact check all my paperwork and take as much time as you want.
I'll do that.
That doesn't...
Great.
Wait, if this mission is fake and you all die, when we get back... You can find out if I was telling the truth or not.
I mean, Darian, you saw us in action, you know.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. This guy is a murderer.
All of them are alive.
Which guy?
Not a murderer.
Which guy's a murderer?
Both of them. They just killed a lot of people.
Not a murderer. Really. They're alive. No fatalities.
It's fine.
I mean, we killed several of the crew of that other ship.
I'm not sure any of that was legal, to be honest.
I did not.
Why have we not commandeered their cargo?
Didn't you shred a guy to, like, little pieces?
To unconsciousness.
Whatever you gotta tell yourself. That guy's
Alex,
still bleeding out on the floor of the other ship.
Can we get a status on that guy? How's he doing?
Alex, can I, like, message back to my admiral or some sort of HQ
It would take a few hours to bounce it back and forth.
What do you mean by my admiral? Do you not mean the admiral that belongs to all of us.
I mean, the admiral that trusted me with this mission and made the mistake of trusting you with this mission.
Wow.
So that's going to be all right.
Okay, Alex, I want to like send a wave or whatever.
You want to send a Google Wave?
I want to send a Google Wave.
All right. Now we're in the future. Imaginary
future. Just even though like I know it won't get there till later, just being like, you know, progress report, I'm missing these two people, we're proceeding anyway.
Okay.
Everything's highly irregular.
Yeah, you walk up to a random computer and why don't you, you know, just send it out, Robin. Give me some sort of roll, see how well you do.
Okay. Just a regular roll, or should I mean
let's do computer operations.
There's radio.
Oh, there is radio. You're right. Yeah, that's radio.
I have radio operation. What just happened to my... I have a one? Yeah. What does that mean if I have a one?
So it's just 2d10 plus one.
Sorry, say that again?
It's 2d10 plus one. So Iris walks up to like a random console, and like punches a few things, and a message that essentially goes out. You know, she pretty much says as she's walking, she's like, "Update recording, update report to Admiral Wilkerson. You know, two people missing. Continuing without them."
I want to put in about the whole hostage situation when I showed up.
Yeah,
like, a little bit forthcoming.
Possible insubordinates.
And then Warren is not a hostage. She's a legitimate prisoner.
Uh-huh.
Iris, the last words she says is possible insubordinates, and she hits like send.
So,
can I hack that message? I mean, I almost certainly can.
To yeah, do what? Probably. Like, what does that mean?
To make it say, like, these guys are great.
We clearly have not met MacAndrews.
Yeah, sure. So while Denver is doing that, what are the... Go ahead. I'll let you give it a try, Kevin.
I'm going to distract the ensign so that Denver has an easier job hacking the database.
So, Iris...
Can I access Iris' social media accounts here?
No, so Iris, you can easily tell that... Denver tried to hack into because it's a critical fail.
It is a critical fail. You're right.
So you can easily tell that he was trying to hack in and modify your message, pretty much right in front of you as you stand. You kind of like, you're like.
So what do you do? Highly irregular.
Wait, what's his rank? Who are you?
He's also an ensign.
Okay.
He's a private.
The private. Yes.
Is that lower or higher than an ensign?
That's about the same. It's more like foot soldiery.
Okay.
I mean, one's definitely higher than the other, but...
Private MacAndrews, I noticed that you just attempted to hack my electronic correspondence.
I will be submitting this
information through the appropriate channels, and you can expect to be disciplined for it later.
Oh.
I give you a disapproving look, MacAndrews.
Somebody from your own crew, Mullen, trying to hack something crazy.
So
I've seen MacAndrews in combat. I trust him.
I haven't seen Ensign Weiss
in combat. The only one I've seen is Lieutenant Commander. Was it Pittsburgh or something like that?
Pittman.
And he went a little off the rails. He didn't exactly keep his cool.
Just heat of combat, Mullen.
Right, I want to pull the lieutenant commander aside as I like go to walk out of the room and be like...
Which one? No. There's two of them.
Pittman.
Mullen and Pittman.
Yeah, they've obviously made a huge mistake here.
Mullen. And be like, Mullen. You know, sir, you know, you're in charge here, and I respect your authority. It seems that some of your crew are a little insubordinate. Is this normal? Like, are we good to proceed as instructed?
We'll proceed, but you have to understand there's a lot of conflicting orders here.
I just have my orders from the Admiral. I have nothing that's conflicting about it. I can show them to you again if you'd like. I'm not questioning the authenticity
of your orders, but you have to understand that they conflict with the orders we received at the beginning of the mission.
Well, I mean, I can explain that. I have high level clearance, and I can't give you the particulars of it, but I was able to get more of a details ping on Rose Willis's location, which is why we know that she's closer. So really, it's thanks to me that you guys
wait,
are
isn't she on a planet?
A few days shaved off this mission.
All right, I say that's fine. Let's get going. I'll tell the security to keep the captain under 24-hour watch.
Commander, with all due respect, are we sure that we can trust the captain's former crew to detain him?
Not at all. But we have other orders for a more important mission here.
Can we just space him and be done with it?
Say
that was basically my question. But
oh. So no, I mean,
wasn't somebody whining about lawyers and tribunals and proper representation or something like that?
I think it was the guy we were trying to kill. I think.
Can we just have the cat do it and say she went space crazy?
You talking about the Cerulean?
Just have Officer Pittman do it because he's already space crazy.
There you go. No problem.
I thought that Rose Willis was on a planet.
We saw a picture of her on a planet. We don't know if she's still on the planet.
Well, we were going to the planet because that's where she was.
That was right, because the ship was disabled on the planet.
I have the coordinates. Why don't we go back to the bridge and I'll plug them in and you can...
Okay, but I do want to ask the new ensign, whatever your name is, because it's not on my...
Weiss. Iris 20. Weiss.
Iris Weiss, right. So I want to ask you, do you have more information about those two people that are supposed to be here? Like, is there some reason that we should make an effort to get them? Like, one of them is a super expert on Rose Willis.
Which is...
Uh-oh, Robin said.
Yeah, so, I mean, I did some research on them before.
Did Robin appear for anybody else or just me?
I did some research on those guys before, and I just found that they were real people. They were, like, just regular dudes.
So they don't have any, like, expertise or anything that would make us want to try and hunt them down? We should just...
I don't think so. I mean, Alex, did I find anything, like, special about them? It just seems like they were just totally regular.
No, they're just like ensigns and privates. They're just, like, grunts.
Okay.
Just bodies.
All right. I mean, we do always need bodies, but usually there's NPCs around to throw in front of the bullets. So, like, whatever.
Robin's computer crashed. She's getting back in.
Right. And I got a critical success to hacker social media.
Yes, you did. All right, so...
So how many pictures is that he's going to be pinging to me?
All of them.
Oh, so my God, all of them.
You get into her Facebook, and it's pretty much just like... It's like, pictures of her on the bridge of, like, wherever
like
ship she visits.
On the bridge.
Yeah, whatever ship she visits, she takes, like a selfie on the bridge.
Like, Captain Life, like, sitting in the chair.
I have a question about all this.
Yes.
But this is
really why do we care?
Yeah.
Oh, I think there's reasons.
I don't really want it to.
Let's get on the steel and make our way to whatever the new coordinates are.
Okay.
Yeah, Chris has a good point. Every time you say Rose Willis. No, I think we already pointed this out. It sounds like Bruce Willis. Yeah, there's a few similarities to the fifth element in this mission. I think we pointed them out early on and it became a game that was too easy. We're on a cruise ship. In space, hunting for Rose Willis.
So you make your way. So Megan obviously stays behind. The
wait,
only
who
people
stays behind?
Megan, the officer, security officer.
Security officer.
Oh wait, she was there. Oh, fuck, Alex, you're ruining my.
No, I mentioned that she was there. You're ruining your own by not listening. Who's there? She was the one to not defend, not spacing him, not spacing Warren.
Oh well, she doesn't want to space again. I'm not interested anymore.
So you make your way back to the ship, and Pittman's like, so I guess we're abandoning Foster and Pena. I mean, are you sure they weren't part of your crew to begin with? You like kind of like one last.
Quite sure.
I say, are you questioning my ability to keep track of the people, my squad?
I mean,
it sounds like that's what you're doing.
He like looks down at his document, and just like, all right. So you get on board this bad boy here. Boop, 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 boop. Obviously, it's a much smaller ship. So you sort of take you go in a perpendicular direction of where the cruise ship was heading. You pretty much go into, 90 degrees from where it was heading.
On which axis?
So do we have our own, like, area, or are we, how is this ship?
No, so it's just sort of looked like it's meant to, like, fly very short distances, maybe no more than, like, 12 hours. It's, like, more like a courier ship, right?
Okay, so we're all, like, sitting in seats or whatever.
Yeah, pretty much. Okay. Yeah, so you're all...
Where would this have come from if it's only like a 12-hour range vessel? And how far is 12 hours in
space? Can I do a search on my space maps?
Well, I was thinking about looking at the coordinates of your ship because I'm the pilot.
So definitely, these kind of ships
definitely
are very...
have some independent verification that they're not like flying us into a black hole here.
So yeah. These kind of ships are very common. I mean, there's like thousands of them flying in space, right? Like, you would be surprised if within an hour's flight, you didn't run into like two or three more in your sensors, kind of thing.
Right, but so that's kind of my point. Like, are there tons of places that a ship could get to? Like, I have no idea what 12 hours is.
Yeah, 12 hours is
this space travel.
12 hours is plenty. 12 hours, you could be within a dozen planets in 12 hours.
Oh.
Hello.
Oh, okay. That's
great. Hey, welcome back.
Hi. We're on the film engine here.
We're on the steel heading and the coordinates that you entered as the trap. I mean, great location.
So well, then
we're
what
having,
I want to do
we're
is look at
Dorian
those
double check yeah. those coordinates real quick.
Yeah, exactly. I want to look at them and compare them to the space charts and my okay. knowledge of the area.
Sure. Go ahead and do astrogation or whatever equivalent is.
I'm gonna do piloting spacecraft. That's what I'm gonna do.
Okay.
It's 16.
Okay, so looking at it, it could have come from two of the planets, right? Especially if it's like a courier ship, it could have been carrying small supplies or data. We're just people from one planet to another. There are multiple planets and a couple of outposts and even a space station that it could have been redirected quickly from in order to get to the nettle.
Okay, the only problem is that we don't give a shit. We want to know about where we're going.
Yeah, what about where she's punching in that we're going? Is that like, does it say like... blank space where she's pointing, but when I pull up like my corresponding historical charts, there's like a giant forbidden zone do not enter sign
okay.
on it.
So I mean, you're not entirely sure based on your role, but it seems like she targeted kind of like there's an outpost that's maybe 30 degrees or 30 minutes away from where she point from where she's put the coordinates in. They kind of look like they're in the middle of blank space. There's no like do not enter zone, no anything, but it's just like it doesn't seem to be anywhere in particular.
Okay, that's fine. So my last question on the subject is where is this in relation to the planet that we were supposed to go to?
Oh, like 2 days travel.
Alright, so Alex, I wanna use my special power called I Know a Guy. I have a 15% chance of having a rank 1 contact wherever I am.
Wow. What's rank 1? Tell me about that. Lay it on me.
I kind of know a guy.
Yeah. Okay, so 15%, huh?
So I'll roll like a 1d20 and then 1 through... Or I'll just roll a d100.
Do
100,
and 1 through 15, you succeed.
Oh! Ooh. Oh! Turns out they didn't empty out the ship before they commandeered it. Some guy comes wandering out of the bathroom. Denver is like, hey, I know that guy.
Denver, one of your contacts begins to blink, like one of your little notifications on the side.
Okay, yeah.
It's Clippy.
A little while ago, you managed to send H on a little mission to find out more about Wilkerson, but you Wilgers, H comes back to you, and in a little like robotic voice, obviously only inside your helmet, says, reminds you essentially that you are pretty much on a very personal contact with one of her aides.
Wilkerson's aides.
Yes, the admiral's aides. Like you are.
Okay,
like,
that I think is on the ship.
No, that is like within communications range.
Yeah. Okay. I'll open up a channel and be like, "What the fuck is this bullshit?"
So the other person, it's a longtime friend of yours. Name's Earl Parks. He says,
"Earl, give me the skinny, Earl. We know what's going on."
He says, "Hey, Denver. Oh, hey. What are you doing in this side of space?
You know, hacking shit."
Yeah, same old Denver.
That's right.
How does
That's
he make I'm friends?
Listen, he's just
has this one.
You old space like,
the
pirate.
Skill, the skill is called I know a guy.
Yeah, so this is the guy. I know.
There is one guy.
There's a 50% chance that guy is going to appear anywhere.
I mean, yeah. I was like, so I was thinking, should I do 85 to 100? I'm like, no, let's do 1 to 15. And Kevin rolled a 1. So so he's like, hey, so what's up, man? Long time no hear.
We're on this FUVAR mission. We just left the nettle. We're with Ensign Iris. Weiss. Some kind Iris? Of bullshit.
Oh, he's like, Weiss?
Yeah.
He's like, she's tight. Some goody two shoes up and coming ensign.
I know, right? What's up with that?
No time. I don't know, man. Wilkerson loves her.
That's a mistake. All right. No, well,
really?
He said, "Be nice to her. She's gonna be your captain some point soon."
Yeah. Well. Fine. Whatever. tell me what the hell is this mission? Why is it all fucked up? Why don't we like have orders that are direct?
Why can't we get two sets of orders that match?
Yeah.
He says, they're supposed to be Viola Vega, the one from the scrapyard.
I say, hold on, guys, I think I'm getting a third set of conflicting orders here.
No, she was supposed to send you correction or something. It was the captain of the nettle was supposed to give it to you.
Are you saying
turns out he was a real scumbag.
You're saying that our
the guy was a royal asshole.
Oh, yeah, I heard that guy's a douche.
Yeah, I heard he named the ship the Nettle just to get back everybody.
He totally named it. I remember, I had to put the paperwork through. I almost scrapped it.
What a...
He says, yeah, he was supposed to give you the matching orders from the steel, right? Iron? Whatever. I don't remember.
Exactly. All right, well, we still up for that racquetball game on Tuesday?
Ah, space racquetball is the best. See you then.
Yeah, totally, man.
You'll disconnect. Then,
yeah, I'll disconnect and delete that racquetball invite from my calendar.
Oh!
Back to zero friends, Denver.
You knew a guy.
Definitely knew a guy.
Oh, by the way, Chris is telling us that we like completely screwed up everything.
Oh, no.
What? I think there was supposed to be some roll, whether or not.
Listen, we're supposed to roll this. Or this is supposed to be more of a
listen
interaction.
We fly by a special set of rules here.
Kevin, you told me out of 1 to 15, this is like your best friend.
No, I said a rank 1 contact. That's you're supposed to know the rules. That's not my fault.
Yeah, it's probably.
You're supposed to roll to see whether like the guy can actually tell you anything useful.
Earl hates you too, because you ruined it by deleting him. He sees when you delete him.
Oh, no, he saw it. He got like a notification.
He got a notification.
Oh, God damn it.
You forgot to hit the thing that says don't send a response.
Literally,
yeah, after accidentally sent a response.
Literally after talking to him, it says like...
Chris says we get the contact, it's fine.
Okay.
Also, I promised all of our social media followers that we would mess up the rules and Chris would correct us, so we are on track. Everything's great.
Solid.
Great job.
All right, so yeah, so like Denver like ends up kind of like sitting there and like talking to himself for a little while. You guys see him like
communicating totally with normal. Somebody.
So what you're saying is we don't have to start the session all over again. Chris is giving us the green light.
Okay, because I was away. Did we start flying yet?
Yes, you are flying.
Okay, great.
We've actually started flying. Yet. I was like, we've been flying. Yeah, we started flying.
We've been flying at every moment of this campaign.
That's yeah. true.
But we're flying in the direction of the coordinates that I gave.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which, so once again, Nick, like you saw on your charts, it's kind of leading to like nowhere, right? It's not even a space station. It's not.
Yeah. Also, no... I tell Lieutenant Commander Mullen all that stuff, by the way. I point out to him that we're going like, I mean, whatever. If we can get to dozens of planets in 12 hours, then a 2-day trip is like pretty massive, right? We're going not even remotely close to where we were supposed to meet Rose Willis, and I'm concerned.
I'll take it immediately to Pittman. I say, like, what the hell is this? We're going to the middle of nowhere.
He's gonna go crazy and kill everybody if you get him riled up.
I don't know. He wasn't really that good at killing people, so
he's gonna go crazy and try to kill everybody. We're gonna have to kill him.
And Stanton Pierce can kill him into unconsciousness.
I'm just saying, if Pittman dies, it wouldn't be so bad because it would kind of clear up the command structure.
I have it recorded, somebody. By the way.
Pittman like looks at the like the map that you give him.
Nice.
And
navigation was not his best subject.
No, it's not. So he like looks at it. He's like, "No, there's like an outpost right here, isn't there?"
I think I think I trust my my pilot to tell me whether or not there is one.
No, it's fine. I was making a Taylor Swift reference. I don't want to talk about it.
Oh, no, no, no.
But then you talked about it anyway.
Please. So, you have the floor.
No, you just keep saying blank space. It's fine.
I don't get it.
This is a song called Blank Space. So he points at the map. He's like, no, look, there's an outpost right there. And he's like pointing, like, obviously, like, 3 degrees off a little bit, right, to you. Like, you know, he's like, no, isn't that where we're going? And he, like, looks at Iris. He's like, isn't this the outpost?
It's like a wink, wink, nudge, nudge situation. I don't really understand. I think the guy's just an idiot.
Okay, do I know if there's an outpost there? Like, I found the coordinates, but I don't know if...
Yeah, no, there's no outpost there.
Okay.
Listen, last time there was a guy who was a total idiot, he turned out to be an idiot and a traitor.
I'm going to be like, no, I don't know.
A little wary of idiots right now.
But, you know, I got these coordinates from... Well, I can't go into the details because they're classified, but
they're more accurate than the previous ones.
I think we're getting to the point where we need to know what we're going towards then.
The place where a message was intercepted from this location that was sent by Rose Willis.
The reason that it seems to be a void on the map is because there's from a there. Massive black hole right where we're going.
That's why
we can't find anything on the star chart.
Also known as blank space.
I say, Ensign Weiss, how exactly are we supposed to prepare for whatever is out there if you won't tell us what it is we're heading towards? Are we just going to float around the middle of nowhere?
I say, to be fair, Lieutenant Commander, a Marine is always prepared.
Doesn't hurt to be more prepared.
Wait, sorry, what? Say that again?
So I will privately message Commander Mullen and say, I got in contact with one of my... associates, and it looks like Ensign Iris's information checks out. But
good work, Megan Drews.
Alternate allegiances.
I will privately message Commander Mullen and say I'm also checking out Ensign Iris.
And I'm also.
It's like, God damn it, Dorian! Keep your eye on the prize.
That's what I just told you I'm doing.
Oh no!
I can hear you setting him up. Why? All right.
Good night, everybody.
Following orders, then you know you all should be in a different line of work. These are the orders. This is the coordinates. You know, I suggest you prepare to retrieve and extract the target.
From what exactly?
What?
Of the void of space?
You're in the Navy. We don't always know what we're walking into.
As you ask from what exactly, a shipwide like alarm begins to like blare.
So just like the alarm in the one room that we're all sitting in.
Yeah, yeah. I said shipwide alarm, right? So
now what?
So you end up finding yourself
that wasn't the last thing hit us.
This asteroid field wasn't here the last time I was in the Alderaan system.
So the ship begins to slow down, because it seems like the location is actually, this is the location that Iris plugged into the computer, and it begins to like slow down here, and there's like a planet off in the distance, Oh wait, this isn't supposed to be planet. Whatever, it doesn't matter. So it's like a dead planet, right? It's like a dead planet. There's no life to it. It's broken up. It's basically just like a giant asteroid field.
So we don't mark these kinds of things on our astrogation charts. When there's giant asteroid fields, we're like,
well,
nobody lives there, so like
nobody cares anymore. Move on.
Well, also, I mean, originally, the captain that we're trying to, Captain Willis, was on some kind of uncharted planet, right? Or some kind of, like, off-charts planet.
This planet is, like, super... This does not seem to be the planet where Rose ended up sending her communications from. This is just, like, a dead planet. It's like,
how close are we to the area of the coordinates, though?
You are maybe just like
need to navigate
like 10 minutes into the asteroid field.
So an asteroid, we think.
Yeah, that seems like where. Right, like it's within the field. Like it's you're like 10 minutes away. You just have to slow down because at the speed you were going, you can't just blast through this asteroid field.
Yeah, who's flying this thing?
Can I get behind the wheel here? And
well,
I
so
can
far,
blast
it's through been like field. Autopilot because autopilot doesn't need a lot of help in flying.
I vote we go with the autopilot.
So it's like exiting over speed.
No, I think we need Dorian's expertise here.
Alex, I'm going to turn to the Cyrillian and I'm going to ask them, do you have any idea what is going on here?
Can we find out why the Cyrillian is here?
Cyrillian with us.
The Cyrillian kind of stands in the back and being addressed, he's a little bit surprised that he's being addressed. And then he sort of looks down and he says, I think I have a clue.
Could you? I didn't even know he could talk.
Could you tell us?
He just beamed it into our brains.
The clue? I speak Cyrillian, so like whatever.
Me too. I say out with it then, man.
He says, I'd rather if you don't mind, I'd rather see for myself before I say anything.
I'd rather reveal the clue at the perfect climactic moment.
And he like looks off into the view screen where like the
he looks
asteroid is about to hit the ship, right?
Okay. Yeah, he's like Dorian, Dorian, would you dodge that asteroid, please? Oh no!
Oh, we're dead. All right.
Everybody. So why don't you give me a piloting check to see how well you navigate? They're pretty far apart.
So let's just set the scene here for a moment. So. We're all on this one in this one little room, right? Are we agreed that we're going towards this specific coordinates, even if they're like inside a dangerous asteroid field? Especially my commanding officer, is that what you want us to do?
We came all this way. Let's see what's up.
All right, I'm gonna slide, behind the pilot's chair, and I'm gonna like look to the left and look to the right, and I'm gonna turn to Ensign Iris, and I'm gonna say, being a pilot, it's the only thing I care about. Being in the Navy, it's the only thing I care about. And by God, I'm going to get us to that asteroid.
That's very admirable.
I crack my knuckles.
I can only imagine that you'd be more successful at that if you spent more time navigating and less time talking.
Please, you'd roll be surprised. Space. I navigate best.
Nick, I'm gonna roll it for you if you don't
no,
roll it.
No, you can't roll it for me. You don't know how to role play.
You don't have that authority.
Nobody
please,
knows how to role play. Obviously.
Just roll the dice.
Well, so Alex,
it's called role play.
I'm gonna walk away. Like I don't.
First of all, what we're here to do is role play, but also I get +5 to my skill checks if I'm showing off while I'm using those skills.
I apologize.
So you have to bear this, Robin.
So anyway, I say to Ensign Ivy, actually, I fly best in the company of a beautiful woman.
I kill myself.
Yes, Denver kills himself.
He does like the Need for Speed like 4 or whatever, where the guy like pilots like looking to the side, right? Like,
yeah, exactly.
He looks at Iris like, the entire time while piloting.
I'm working the controls, and I'm just like, see that asteroid? It almost hit us, but
I'm just like, this makes no logical sense.
All right, so Dorian,
better directed towards paying attention to the task at hand.
Take a +5 for showboating and add your piloting space.
Okay, the 19.
Oh, 19 is like you do very well. The asteroids are pretty far apart. There's only like a few fast moving little ones, and even those, they don't, you know, you manage to dodge those. Every now and then you hear like a little clink, but not anything that would do any sort of damage, you know, like barely any external damage to
them. You're a leaf on the wind.
Somebody's,
like, you have to barrel roll the whole time.
So Alex, can I get to the ship's scanners and try to see if there's any like sort of like EM signals?
Wait, yeah, I thought scanners weren't a thing in space.
Yeah, sure. You walk up to like the co-pilot seat, which is vacant, and you like hop in.
Seems like an oversight.
Let's say, hey, Dorian, how's it going?
I say I fly even better in the company of two beautiful people.
Alex, can I notice what he's doing, and can I use the fact that I tracked that message I intercepted? And try to jury-rig some kind of, like, reverse...
You want
to
backtrack the trace route?
Yeah.
All right.
So, why don't... So, Kevin...
Like, now we're closer, and maybe that would be useful information.
Yeah, so why don't you guys both give me... Robin, you jury-rig, and Kevin, you do a scan, which is, like, whatever... Is there, like, some sort of scan use, computer use, something along
that? You know, I have a computer operation...
That's more like ship operation, though.
So I have six and jury rig.
There's a computer on board the ship. That's just how you do.
So I do 2d10 plus six. That's just how it works.
Yep.
I have computer hacking.
I mean, it's not really hacking. It's like right in front of you.
Like, just looking at the giant thing going around.
Why don't we ask the
audience
what he should use?
We've all this separately, right?
I have pick locks and cryptography.
I mean, I can do this myself. Like, I've also got, like,
what is a
other stuff.
What Whoa. Is a scanner if not a...
All right.
Not a lock.
I just want to, like, walk through and see what Denver's broken. Doing, Alex, and be like, oh, interesting. Mind if I...
All right, so Denver, why don't you just give me a...
Maybe the computer scanning operation is unlocked by, like, you solving a bunch of anagrams.
Let's hope not.
Why don't you, Kevin? Why don't you give me a research check? Right?
I
don't.
Wanna, yeah. All right. I can do that.
I don't want to give you a minus 10.
Didn't Ensign Weiss just like jump in here?
Yeah. So she's. Sure. I mean, so he's there, like struggling. He's like looking around. He's kind of like pressing a button or two. And she walks behind him. And she's like, "Oh no, this is what you're trying to do." And she like reaches over her shoulder and like plays with the controls a little bit. And she takes a 3D. Picture of a really, really big asteroid, and she says, I think the signal's coming from right behind there.
I say, you know there's a hotkey to do that.
I look at her and I say, wow, it's very impressive, as I, you know, without looking at all, dodge two asteroids that are, like, just about to collapse on the ship.
Ooh, fancy Dorian. Nice dodge, nice dodge. You see the Cerulean, like, just flinch for, like, a second as the asteroids come really close, but, like, no sort of, you know, doesn't say anything. So you approach, the location is pretty much right in front of you behind this asteroid. Dorian very successfully maneuvers the ship around, and as you come around, you see, it's halftime. Let's take a 2-minute break, and we will...
Oh, wow. That was so suspenseful!
That was amazing!
Oh, sorry guys, it's exactly 8:30. You know, just nothing I can do about that. So let's take a 2-minute break, 2-minute right. bathroom break. We'll come back in 2 minutes and resume.
Right.
Okay, so as the ship circles around this asteroid,
expertly,
yeah, you see in the distance something that you have only seen in history books.
The distant shore.
A koala.
Yeah, you weren't sure that any of these actually survived, but it seems like a very, very old star, like a slipstream star. So this is what when the generation ships left Earth hundreds of years ago, they took these gates with them to establish them in faraway locations. And around this giant asteroid behind it is this star. It sort of looks like this. I couldn't find a better picture. So it's just kind of by itself. There's a whole bunch of debris around it. There's a, like I said, there's a, like asteroid field around it, you know, but it's...
Is it even intact?
It is intact.
Is it on?
I'm a little confused. You said it's a slipstream star, so that means it is actually a like ball of superheated gas, or it is a space station, or what?
It's think of it like a Stargate, right? You like okay, hop so into it.
This is a thing constructed of metal. This is not a gigantic ball of gas.
Correct.
Okay.
All right. So you would like hop into it and end up elsewhere, kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, right. So this was supposed to make. So, like I said, these have not, this, you know, construction hasn't been seen for, like, hundreds of years since the generation ships went missing.
And this is what launched the generation ships.
Well, is this a launching point or an ending point?
So what they would do is the generation ships would take these to other locations, and then you would essentially jump to those locations, but at some point the generation ships all went missing. This is both, right?
So you need one on each end in order to go between them, is your point?
Yeah.
So would we guess that this is a starting point?
Yep.
Okay.
Or an ending point. There, you can go back and forth between them.
So why did they stop making it? But meaning because it's nearer our civilization.
We're not out far enough that the generation ships would have put the other side down, right?
Right.
Okay.
Why did they stop making these?
So it's not that they stopped making them. It's just that this is a very, very old model. This model, like, you're surprised to see that this model isn't, like, hasn't been, like, scavenged and broken into a million pieces kind of thing, right?
So I have an idea. Let's scavenge this motherfucker.
Oh, no, let's just take it to wherever it goes.
So this is exactly where the signal's coming from, by the way.
So can we try to hail this thing?
Dorian punches it straight into the Stargate.
Can we also pull the Cyrillian aside and...
Murder him?
To him?
I'm pretty sure he's not allowed to see this.
I don't speak Cyrillian, right? So, like, I didn't hear that he knew what was going on before, but other people did. Like, did I notice that they were having a conversation? Can I be like, does he know something?
But is he supposed to, what's the Cyrillian supposed to know?
Well, no, so before he was like, oh, I think I know what's going on, but I'm going to be an asshole and I'll tell you guys. Yeah, until like, I already
well, then nobody asked him any follow-up questions. We all just
okay,
like,
well,
back
you know.
To that.
All right. Well,
I think we had like, what's the clue, and he said, "I'm not going to."
Hey, Zarg, you care to explain?
I think it's Zarin.
Zarin takes a step forward and like kind of puts his hand against the view screen, and he says,
"It's not how that works."
Kevin's like, "Don't touch the monitor, please."
Yes, please.
It shatters, opening us to space.
And he was like, I haven't seen technology this ancient in my lifetime. And he like, this is, and he like kind of like nods to himself and he's like, this is incredible. And he like takes out like a little computer and starts like punching things into it.
Is this computer like compatible with our technology?
I mean, they gave us a lot of their technology.
Okay, so, okay, well...
Someone translate for me?
Hack it.
Is it possible if you were to hack it, or is it like, oh no, duh, you wouldn't do that?
No, you can't hack it.
I think you'd have to, like, physically try to interact with it. It doesn't, you know, from what you've seen, the similar models, they're not really, like, connect to anything.
Okay, so can I just position myself that I can zoom in with my computer eye and see what's on his screen?
Yes. So, like, you could try. So, do you speak Cerulean?
Oh, I can just take pictures of everything.
He could research how to speak Cyrillian right now.
Okay, yeah, I mean, you end up taking pictures, and, like, so I'm gonna have you do that for, like, a little while, Kevin.
Yeah, no, right.
All right, I say, Lieutenant Glass, can you hail that thing and see if anybody's over there, if,
I give you Captain a wink, Willis Lieutenant Commander, and then I quickly hit the hail space station button on my console.
That's why they installed that button.
Give me.
That's the thing that they use.
It works.
So,
Denver taught you all about hotkeys.
So, with your hotkey pressed, you end up just sending out like a hail to them, and you get a lot of static. There's definitely some sort of message trying to come through, but just a basic hail won't do it.
Can you enhance that signal? Well,
my hotkey plays hail to the chief at them.
Oh God.
So
this is why you're fired.
Suicide pills.
If you have roll radio use, please.
Roll radio use.
Yes.
My God, we're still using radios.
They need to somehow amplify their signal. Maybe I can do that.
Wow.
Oh, oh no. break the radio.
In why anger, are you rolling it?
My God.
Smash the button.
Pulls out his gun.
Hitting the
stop joking. That's actually what happens.
Mullen reaches over you, and he's like, "Come on, man! What are they saying?" And he like kind of like tries to press like random things in, and like
just,
it like
just pull
jams
off
up your
buttons.
Console. It like jams up your console for a while, and he accidentally hits like
fire,
navigate like 30 degrees at an angle, and like a big asteroid like kind of like. Pushes it wasn't going very fast, but it like pushes your ship into like a different direction and you have to like restabilize. So give me a piloting check, Dorian.
My God, yeah, Lieutenant Commander, please.
I think we should avoid the asteroids technically.
Alex, do I have enough stuff around me that I could try to figure out a way to
get a clear signal?
Yeah,
I mean there's a whole bunch, you know, this is like a full bridge of a ship.
Like
you can try yeah. So
why don't engineering, jury rig?
You could jury rig. You could try to jury rig, like try to get a clearer signal based on what's coming in.
Okay.
I turn to Ensign Pierce, and I say, "Don't worry, I'll get us out of this." And I like reach behind me and just sort of deftly, without looking, touch a few controls.
As you reach behind you, I say, "Please don't touch me." So
no, I'm facing you.
Okay, wait. I have to check my thing, but can somebody summarize what Chris and Paul are saying in chat for me? Because I saw it, but I didn't.
Oh, they're just talking about radios.
I don't have enough personal bandwidth to read chat and DM at the same time.
Say, because we made fun of using radios. Yes.
Yes. And we get to make fun of radios.
Let's be clear. I made fun of using radios.
So as the ship
you
like strikes, as the ship gets hit by the asteroid, Dorian like. He anticipates which way the ship is going to go and like sort of pivots it in the same direction, and it does a smooth 360 and then like floats right back into like in the same exact position where it was.
He might have even into the skid.
He might have even avoided some of the damage, let's put it that way. Iris like climbs like under the under one of the console, and is like she's like poking around, and there's like a few sparks coming out, and
what the hell.
I just like yank out some wires, and I'm like, "You don't even need these. It's fine."
She's like, "You don't need these," and she like connects them and like ties a few of them together. When she climbs out, it's still like sparking under there a little bit,
it's fine.
But the message becomes a little clearer where you hear like that. There's definitely someone like talking, and then you distinctly get in the background. You get like a SOS message, which all of you are able to receive. Followed by some more like garbled speaking.
What do you mean in the background?
Like in the background,
like literally,
like someone in the background,
noise?
Or like
so
or, like, a frequency in the background.
No. So there's a constant SOS message going during the communication.
It's like an emergency signal.
I'm just trying to understand. Are you saying that we're hearing it over the transmission with the other thing, or there's like
yes.
a separate SOS
transmission? No. They're both coming from the same source.
Can I have my AI H just try to like de-scramble the message?
Bender?
Try to like isolate the.
He was busy trying to help you look at the cerulean stuff. You know what's interesting is it appears in some place has attempted a non-official Navy-approved approach to communication technology, and yet has achieved some kind of result from that. That's interesting. I'll make a note of that for later, Ensign Weiss. Thank you for the example.
What are you like?
Yeah, you'll
log?
Have to explain that at your court-martial.
Oh! Oh my God. The court-martial.
So it definitely looks like an unstable solution, and jury rigging actually ends up having a chance to fail catastrophically after like 10-15 minutes, so we'll see where that goes.
So, well, it looks like they're broadcasting an emergency channel. We should probably get over there and see whether Captain Willis and her crew is still alive.
So Dorian,
I see a docking port right there. Allow me to loop to loop around the station a few times and then
we'll so dock.
Permission granted.
Nick, why don't you tell me what you do? Nick, why don't you tell me exactly? Because you know you had a pretty good role, so why don't you tell me exactly what Dorian does?
Okay, so I mean, is there a nice docking just, port?
Visible? You have 30 seconds. There is.
All right. So Dorian turns around and says, "My friends, we've made it." And I throw another wink at Ensign Piers over there, and I do like this behind me, and I'm like, and we just sort of like gently rock back and forth right to the circle, do a little loop around the top of it, come right back in, and like slide into the docking port, and there's a little hiss of the vacuum.
So as you loop around to the top of it and slide back in, you get pulled into this active slipstream.
Yes, that's exactly what I wanted. You fell
this
for
is
it.
A catastrophic failure.
I mean, no. I mean, I asked him to tell me what he does,
and I was so hoping we were going to just go through the Stargate.
God.
So, Dorian, tell me what you do now that the ship is kind of, it's a little bit out of control since you didn't enter it normal-like.
Well, seeing as how. I'll heavy-handedly point out that I'm an imperturbable kind of guy. You know, I turn around expecting to see us sliding into the docking ring. Instead, I see like flashing colors and whirring control lights and stuff like that. And I say, "Well,
what do those do?"
This is different than my usual dockings. And I try and like. I try and read out how I could stabilize the ship and make sure whatever the hell we're going through is a smooth ride.
All right, so give me a roll. Give me a roll. Here.
I say, don't worry, folks. There's absolutely no way anything else could go wrong here.
All right, so you manage to position the ship perfectly well. You end up catching it just as it's, you know, about to, like, rotate the wrong direction, maybe pop out of the stream. You're not sure how that works, but you just kind of go with the flow, and eventually you get
smooth operator comes over the loudspeakers.
Yeah,
as I
you
press another
you come out the other side. On the other side, it
you've
looks
done a terrible thing.
You'll have to explain Ryan. This at your court martial.
It looks like a seed from some sort of post-apocalyptic. There's a planet. There's like meteors raining down onto this planet. The signal that Iris has set up has been the entire time has been broadcasting. All of a sudden, you hear like an SOS. It says, you know, the SOS Morse code is playing in the background the whole time while the person's speaking. On what seems like a loop, like we've taken refuge on the south side of the planet. We've avoided most of the asteroids. We are in a cave, small cave formation. I repeat, yes, Morse code.
A cave formation? Yeah, I was thinking about the Morse code too, but
they don't use that anymore.
It's like updated Morse code, but we still know it's SOS.
Yeah. You get an SOS, right? And so then the loop restarts again. We are on the south side of the planet. We've taken Redville, and so, you know, it, like, just keeps looping over and over.
All right,
I Lieutenant Glass, I believe you've meteors. Royally fucked up.
I say, no, sir, we were pulled into that, couldn't have anticipated that it would be active after so many centuries.
Robin,
aim was to dock with the station.
I believe, sir, that the aim was to complete the mission, and right there on the planet is our mission, so...
Robin, on the
you'll
on
have
a
to
one...
explain that your jury rigging...
Okay, so your jury rigging just kind of, like, shakes off a little bit, and there's a few more sparks, but nothing terrible happens, so you're fine.
Listen, if it starts to fail, do I get a chance to jury rig it?
No.
Again?
If the ship explodes, we'll all be dead.
It's a catastrophic failure. You'd like
to say,
radio.
Lieutenant Glass, do you think you can set the ship down on the planet without transporting us in time and space or someone?
So a question. Is there behind us the exit aperture?
Yes, so behind you is the exit aperture. It looks like it's taken a bit of a beating from random
asteroids. I see.
Yeah. It's taken a bit of a beating, but it seems like it's kind of like it's just like spinning around in space, right? From like very slowly. But like I said, there are like asteroids like all over the place, and it looks like it's.
I say, Lieutenant Commander. Not only do we, of course, have an easy way home, but I would be glad to set us down on the planet. I presume the southern side, as they said, is where you want to go, or towards the distress.
Yeah, and with less showboating this time.
Do we have more exact coordinates than the south of the planet?
Yeah, so I assume we can like triangulate.
Oh, yeah, you know, set it down. Better than nothing, source really. We've limited half the planet.
Hold on, I'm getting like pieces of message because you guys are all talking at the same time.
Is there any way, just track
the signal and set it down where the signal origin is.
Yeah, somebody research where that signal is.
All right, so as Dorian begins to fly to the south side, does anybody have astrogation? Can we get a
astronavigation?
Astronavigation.
Why do you think we ended up on like the ass end of space?
Really, I don't think anybody has it.
I mean, I have spacecraft engineering.
We get
there's actually a separate navigation thing.
Iris, why don't you just jerry rig up another thing to like tell us when the signal's getting stronger, and we can just, you know, kind of suss it out.
Yeah, you can.
Well, isn't that what I sort of did before too? I mean, can't I use whatever
it wears off after a while. Jerry rigging is only for like 10 minutes. So different. If you want like another role. Like okay. You're like doing a little bit different, right? Like this is not communication. This is
Can I do it on like a handheld device, like not through the ship, so that like if we were to exit the ship I could, you know.
Sure. So you can like connect a handheld device to the ship kind of thing.
Great. Once we get close enough,
it's going to be clear what's going on.
Maybe Denver can help you with that.
My jury rigging or my electrical engineering?
Denver or Benver?
So no, it's jury rigging because you're trying to do something that you don't really have.
By the way, what did I ever see? What did I see in that Cyrillian's computer screen?
Oh, so he was. So from your research and with Kevin, you ended up seeing that he's taking furious notes about like the location of the slipstream and possible, like where it can. Where it can go, like the different, you know, he's like writing down
furiously taking notes,
like hundreds of locations. He's listing them, some by name, some by number, where this potential can go. Okay, so Robin,
wait, he's listing really quick. The Cerulean is listing locations of what
that the slipstream could end up at.
He's worried the human that some one of the human.
He knew it was active the whole time, and he's great.
He's worried that one of the human generational ships has escaped their destructive grasp, and he needs to find out where they are so he can blow it up.
No, you don't know that. Anyway,
we should probably flush him out the airlock right now.
Yeah,
grab his computer.
Okay, let's hold a Cyrillian court-martial immediately.
Okay, so as
I rolled my jury.
Yeah, I see it. As you fly around the south side, Iris is able to jury-rig the comm system to see if you can track, get like a clear location on this target. And as you go around the side, facing away from the planet, you end up running into a real live generation ship. It is massive.
Generation ship's alive.
Its engines look unstable. They're glowing with some sort of something. You don't exactly know what it is just from look, but it definitely, you know, the rest of the ship is dark, but just its engines are glowing some sort of almost like a pulsing like radioactive hue.
Say, mother of God.
And so
it's a spaceship.
It's all real.
And so the message is coming from the south of the planet. It's essentially, you know, it loops. You can pretty much pinpoint Iris exactly where within like a 100-meter radius as to where it is on the planet.
It's coming from the house.
I say, Lieutenant Commander, my God, we could go down to the planet, but shouldn't we do something about this ship?
So it is the ship is.
Wait, the ship isn't floating in space, or it's on the planet?
No, it's floating. It's floating like through space. It's like, you know, upside down by space terms, which means not active.
Nothing.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you were okay.
But it's.
But the radio signal is coming from the
ship or the planet?
No, the planet.
Let's say we stick to the mission.
Generational ship right here.
I agree.
Well, I said, but we have to get to Lieutenant the planet. We don't even know what the mission was. We were just supposed to find
incorrect.
Out.
Incorrect. The mission was to find Rose Willis. I have the coordinates. The mission is on track.
No. Wait, your coordinates took us back there. I'm the one who brought us here. Now there's a fucking generational ship, the greatest discovery in the last like 500 years, and you guys are just like, well, Rose might be down there on that planet, so we'd better go down there.
Yeah.
That's preposterous.
Yeah. Let's do it.
Just because we went through a slipstream doesn't make me any less of a...
We can check the ship on the way back.
I concur.
I think, all right.
Yeah, I mean, if that generation ship has been there for like 5,000 years, then like I don't think it's going anywhere.
Yeah, right.
Does it look like it's going to zoom off there, Lieutenant Glass?
To do anything about it. I mean, that ship dwarfs our own ship in scale. If there's something on the ship, if there's something to deal with, we are not equipped to deal with that. We can inform the Navy. They can come back with adequate resources, but we have a specific mission
here. Who brought this buzzkill along? What the hell? All right, fine. Fine. We've triangulated the signal.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Fine. Fine. So I press a button and a fancy looking joystick like slides up out of a panel and I grab it and I just like really expertly, you know, manually navigate us down to the planet surface.
So you're not showboating.
No. I'm doubling down on my showboating.
Even though you were ordered not to?
Even though I was ordered not to.
Got it. Do it. He's like, closes his eyes with one hand and is like, swinging the joystick around.
Well, you can't argue with results.
Fair enough.
So, Dorian, like, aims the ship into, like, like a suicide run, like, straight through the atmosphere, being able to read that the atmosphere is a little shaky on this planet. It's not, you know, not very, he just kind of like plows right through, and right as when it seems like it's getting critical, he like pulls back in the joystick and it like slides back and the ship like slowly descends like very easily down on the planet.
And I flash a super dashing smile over to Iris with one of those like twinkles on my
yeah, tooth. But Denver is standing where he thought Iris was, and I smile back.
Oh, all right.
You're
nice.
You're muted, Robin.
I said, yeah, I'm over with the Cyrillian trying to like communicate him with sign language. No one will translate for me.
So the signal is clear. Like the signal that's coming through is you know, like as if it's Denver talking to himself in his head kind of thing. It's very...
Is there anything...
So when we touch down, do we see like our camp or anything?
So it's there's some sort of
like feet from this signal.
So you touch down, you know, within feet from the signal, but it definitely seems like there's some sort of like a cave formation. And one of the things in the signal is that they've managed to escape into a cave formation to escape the atmosphere. And so they've, you know, if so, they're there.
All right, let's go find our lost captain. I check my rifle and hit the button to like let down the boarding ramp.
I say, Commander, I will. I'll initiate shutdown procedures, and Ensign Weiss and I will guard the ship.
Absolutely not.
All right. Is anybody else staying behind?
Nice try, Lieutenant Glass. You're coming with me.
I already have my pistol on me.
I say, Lieutenant, I'd rather be paired with Captain Denver.
We're all going together, so you get your wish.
All right, so Pittman says, he's like, all right, I'll hang back here and get the ship ready to leave. Just go get her.
Keep the engine running.
Nobody asked you, yeah. Pittman.
Actually, I'm gonna lock my control console so Pittman can't do shit to my hotkeys.
That's a terrible idea.
Really, the great idea. Trust him to not blow up the ship.
With the site and need to make a quick getaway, that will not be helpful.
Listen, I rolled a 31. I can get the ship back up and into space in like a bit.
All right, we go into the cave.
Okay, so as you head into the cave, you see that the cave is not actually very deep. The atmosphere is a little thin, so especially with like oxygen. So for those of you that are, you require oxygen some sort breathers. Of like, yeah, oxygen breathers. You require some sort of apparatus, maybe just to kind of you know,
like my
helmet.
UPAS BA-03 medium environmental armor with an 8-hour air supply.
That'll yeah, be, I have mean, one of you those. Like so that? You can breathe the atmosphere. It's just you won't be able to, you know, go for very long with it.
I don't have one. I don't have one of those. I'm gonna have to share with Denver.
I just want to like keep walking and not even notice that everybody else is like.
Why don't you stopping. Need to breathe?
All right, so Alex, I want to use my special power.
Yeah,
I know a guy. Yes, I'm in regular contact wherever I am.
Isn't it once a session or something like that?
No, just kidding. All
right, Kevin.
Let him
Joe from accounting said that from on the rock. Denver.
Let's do it so that we can successfully show how that skill actually works.
No.
It turns out the guy is me. Denver and I know each other from elementary school back in the day.
So like, you
get the fuck back in line.
There's a few masks at the exit of the ship that will, you know, give you like a very limited air supply for those of you that don't have something that'll actually help. But it's, you know, eventually.
So I'm very curious what the Cyrillian's doing.
So the Cyrillian is walking out with you.
Yeah, he's coming with us. I'm not letting him out of my sight.
Is there, going back, is there a reason Ensign Weiss doesn't need to breathe?
I'm a cyborg.
Oh, she's a cyborg.
I don't need to.
Oh, you're a cyborg.
Breathe, eat, or
wait,
sleep.
She's a cyborg?
Yeah, you've been winking at a robot this whole time.
No. Now I'm doubling down again.
Quadrupling down?
Doubling down twice.
Is it, Denver, you want to like, show me a simple hack?
Is it visually obvious that you're a cyborg, or
yes.
is it like...
Yeah. Okay. I mean, can I... How do? Is there a way to show them what I look like?
Not really. She's like... her body is like partially metallic. She's over 200 pounds. She's 6 feet tall. It's the only thing that's like remotely human is like her head and her brain, possibly parts of it.
Nice.
Some parts of it.
Yeah. Everything else, 100% robot.
Everything so else?
Everything else.
As
you
so
hear
as
that,
the
Lieutenant Glass?
Oh, I hear.
As the group walks into the cave, you see a small like fire burning in the distance. As you approach it recklessly, a spear thrusts through your body. As you approach it from a distance, you see that there are three people passed out around the fire.
Three people?
Yeah.
I approach cautiously.
I'm going to take my pistol out and approach cautiously.
I want to approach less cautiously and go in and just survey who's there and say, hello. I'm Lieutenant Dorian Glass.
I say,
I'm
keep it in your pants, Glass.
This is a terrible plan.
I say,
We all know Dorian by now. Can we just like instinctively like thrust an arm and sort of push him towards the back of us?
Instinctively shoot him in the head.
He has to kind of sneak around. And he's like, "Whoa, what's that?" Right? And he like goes up and like goes to one of the people and goes like, "Hello."
And I don't get in my pants. I have my gun drawn, Lieutenant Commander.
Lieutenant, get down.
So do any of these passed out bodies look like the picture of Captain Willis?
So it looks like Captain Rose Willis is actually one of the people.
Intimately aware of her picture.
She has these the veins in her face are turning some sort of like green / blue. Upon hearing Dorian's voice, she like cracks open her eyes, and you see that her eyes are like bloodshot. You also notice she is not using any sort of like breathing equipment or anything along that line. Right?
I call over. I say, Paris, you better get over here.
Yes, sir. All right, I'll examine the.
Can I rip the oxygen mask?
I'd say yes, Ensign. You'd better tend to her two companions. I'll check on Miss Willis.
No, you're not touching any of them. And I will. I'll proceed to see, like, medically examine them. See what's going on.
Okay, give me a medic check, medical thing. What is it that you do?
What is it that you do? He's gonna doctor.
Yeah. So you do a medics check. You kind of like look over. You look at the eyes. You notice that she's suffering from one, a very slow form of asphyxiation as her body's not getting enough oxygen, and two, she's inhaled so much like poisonous gas that's in the atmosphere, even though it's been in very small doses. I mean, she's been breathing it for you have no idea how long. Mm-hmm. So like her body's like barely able to, you know.
And are the other two individuals, they look to have similar symptoms or?
Yeah, you're not sure how, like you haven't really examined them, but neither one of them responds to vocal cues.
All right, let's get them back to the ship.
All right, well, everyone, let's get masks onto these people. And get him back to the ship as soon as we can.
So I'll share my mask with Rose Willis.
I mean, I will help if it looks like they need help, but if I'm just going to be in the way, I'm going to look for any computer equipment.
Okay, so it seems like there's a bunch of like backpacks. Mm-hmm. You're not sure if there's a computer equipment in them.
I'll open them up, as I know how to do with backpacks.
So it looks like there's about like 20 of them.
You going to hack that pack?
Yeah, I'm gonna hack these packs open.
It looks like about 20 of them, Denver, and some of them are like under like they're like locked with, you know, like locks and stuff.
Can I just do like a quick like Wi-Fi scan to see if they are emitting like signals or anything?
Sure, that's pretty simple. You kind of do like a sweep scan, mm-hmm. and you see that every single one of them has something.
All right, well, I'll open one of the ones that's not, locked. So they're all locked.
Yeah, they're all locked. It looks like they're like people's personal belongings that they like grabbed or had or stored or used. It looks like they've been here for a while.
Does anybody have a knife?
Yeah, totally.
We all have knives.
Are the rest of you carrying them back to the ship? Because if
So who's carrying who?
Yeah,
I've got Rose Willis.
All right, so Rose Willis. People. So Dorian has Rose Willis, and she has his mask.
And my heart.
I'm assuming Perez has mask plus another person,
mm-hmm.
and Iris can carry one, but you don't have a mask, and Mullen, you don't have a mask either.
Yeah, so I mean, Denver, I can very easily carry one of them, but if Lieutenant Commander Mullen is carrying them, then I'll go help Denver with the stuff.
Yeah, how long is this going to take? They've been out here for like days.
I mean, I'm just, if you guys are walking back, I'm just going to go back and like grab a bunch of the backpacks and then like follow you out.
Yeah, so Denver grabs one and like cuts one open, and there's like a little data pad that like falls out of it, along with some what it looks like rations, but they were all consumed, and you know, the garbage was being stored in these backpacks.
Is there electronics in there? I missed it.
Yeah, so there's like a data pad fell out.
What it says.
It's encrypted. You could try to crack it if you want.
Oh well, I have cryptography.
Nice.
Commander Mullen, I recommend that if we are going to do extended operations in this cave, or with the things that are in this cave, that we leave and get back onto the ship. It is not safe to be in this atmosphere for extended periods.
Yeah, can I let like Denver do whatever he's doing with that backpack, but like just grab like as many of the rest of them?
I'll just radio everybody to grab whatever they need and bring it back to the ship.
I'm just going to hook them on all the various, like, metal hooks I have protruding from my body. Like, I have a little, like, grappling hook.
Just because you're a cyborg means so you have metal hooks.
Robot.
Ensign Weiss sounds more and more horrifying.
Further dialogue. It's a homemade edition. You're a robot, like, this is not a thing that you buy in IKEA.
You're like a DIY cyborg.
So you have homemade hooks all over your body.
No, just like one really big one that's like a big
just little coat hangers.
Robin's like that guy from Hellraiser, but it's like
right,
but creepier.
Horns, claws.
I normally like use it to like carry my groceries in. From
I don't
want to
know what you normally use it for. All
right, so let's say you grab a bunch of backpacks.
Yeah,
you grab all of them, and you
I
grab
leave
all the
Denver.
People,
I start,
and you head. You grab all the backpacks except the one that Denver's like meticulously like clipping open with like a knife. And you head back to the ship, which is like whatever, a minute away, 60 seconds away.
Cool.
For those of you without masks, this air is extremely uncomfortable. It's almost like almost breathing through a like a coffee stirrer straw. You know, it's like you can't seem to get enough oxygen into your lungs, and the exertion of like carrying stuff is not helping.
Okay.
All right. Well, I'll just leave
what do you want us to do about that? Can we make it back to the ship?
Yeah. You make it back to the ship. You're just like very relieved.
Right, I brave the elements in order to save Rose Willis.
Yeah, that's fine. So you get into the ship. You know, you see her chest begin to rise and fall a little bit. easier, but she does not, you know, she still has her eyes like open. They're kind of wild. They're like looking around everywhere. It doesn't, you know, she does not seem to like recognize you kind of thing.
Can I go over and talk to her?
Yeah.
Ms. Willis, Rose, it's me, Iris. Do you remember me? Can you hear me?
She looks at you and kind of like goes, but
okay, don't try to talk. Just remain calm. Also, tell me everything.
Can this Cyrillian like telepathically link up with her?
Wait, where is the Cyrillian?
So he's been just following you the whole time. Right, he's just kind of following and
he's
writing.
He's just like a little bit of a creeper.
It's just like little path.
I still don't understand why he's here.
I mean, is it clear that like she's in need of medical treatment and is going to die soon?
Oh yeah, I'm gonna
basically shove Ensign Weiss out of the way.
I assumed you were there, like administering
and start
her
trying to and start.
I'll just
trying
to be like treatment. Fix her, save her.
All right, so give me a first aid check here to see. We're gonna practice on Rose first.
Yes.
Yeah,
during
yeah.
Glasses, like,
yeah,
yeah, yeah. Damn it,
I don't think it's called dying. Serious or practice when someone's like dying.
I mean,
I think that's for reals.
You practice medicine.
Yeah. Well, all right.
No, right. Just
in the future, everyone's learned how to actually do it. Nobody practices anymore.
Probably.
In terms of like, so I have, you know, I have medic skills and I've got medical equipment. I also have like an ability where I restore health to a target. Are those the same thing? Is it something where I make the roll check in order to restore the health? Or are they independent things where it's like...
I'm going to say that's a little bit more for like PC combat, right? Okay. Like also a target. Like this isn't like a... Mm. They've taken damage kind of thing. This looks like they're in need of medical attention.
Okay.
Can't you see this woman is dying?
That sounds like it should count.
Okay, so Ensign Perez with... with the... very meticulously walks up to Rose and he like takes off a mask, puts it on her, and then he reaches Shame. Down. Sorry, I apologize. She takes her one finger and she ends up kind of like pressing on like the neck, on like her neck, and like squeezing like a little harder. And Perez says, okay, I know exactly what to do, and ends up just like pulling out this med kit, pulls out this med kit, and like pulls out this like giant needle.
Her head right off.
Proceeds to saw straight through her neck.
I carefully.
Is he traker? He's gonna traker.
Right on her throat.
He says, "Dorian, can you do me a favor? Can you hold down Miss Willis?"
Yes. Anything to save her leg, doctor.
So as
shame
as
on you, Alex.
Don't patronize me.
As Dorian holds the captain down, Perez ends up taking this giant needle and stabbing it right into the lungs of where where the lungs would be, and ends up like pulling on the syringe, and it fills with this like half fluid, half gas that's been like building up in what seems like in her lungs, and Rose ends up like. Once the needle's out, she like takes her first non-raspy, non-like.
Wait! I'm gonna guess what she says. Ow!
No, she just takes like a breath, like her first like normal, almost normal sounding breath.
Robin immediately begins to grill her.
Yeah, sounds like.
So good to see you again. Start talking.
So with your role is fine enough. You end up pretty much doing that to all the three people. It seems like their lungs were being very slowly poisoned, and even though they're not cured, this is the best that you can do with the tools that are currently available to you.
What are you gonna do with all that poison, Doc?
So you end up kind of. They definitely need they need medical attention, like you know, fast. And so this is kind of like the best you could do with what you have.
Yeah, trying to stabilize them.
Yeah. By the way, for our viewers, did we say this before? It turns out that the restore health ability costs action points, so it can only be used in combat. Yeah. So that's good. That's what you said.
Nice call, Alex.
Mm.
You read a book.
He knows things.
Nope. Not that part. So you end up sort of stabilizing the best you can. They begin to breathe normally. Their eyes are still bloodshot. There's nothing you can do about that. The face is like all their veins are like a weird color. It seems like they might need like a full like blood transfusion or something along those lines.
So all right, let's get off this godforsaken place. Get these people back to civilization.
Can I use like a destiny point or something to have some clear eyes in my pocket to help out?
You're all over the map here, Lieutenant Glass.
Right. Cherry rigs some Visine with some like windshield wiper fluid.
Pittman yells back at you guys, "We're locked out of the controls."
I can't fly the controls and Rose Willis.
Well, do you want to fly the ship or not?
I do. Okay. I leave Rose Willis in. Denver is capable hands because I don't trust.
Well, you trust Weiss. Denver? What the hell?
I don't trust Ensign Weiss with her.
Ensign Perez and me hovering.
I'll tell everybody to get busy out of the cockpit.
Denver didn't even make it back to the ship. Denver's still hacking a tablet back in the cave.
Denver's dead. Denver's poisoned.
Oh wait, we're taking off without Denver. All right, that's sad. Anyway,
Perez, you notice that there's a lot of people like huddled around these three like injured people that need like their space and air and so on, right? That they're kind of like everybody's like looking around and like, you know, so, like Iris is like hello, like
trying to get all right, I open the airlock as we take off to make sure that everybody has plenty of air.
All right, everybody, these are three very sick individuals.
I thought you just fixed recovering. Them.
I did not just fix them. I am keeping them alive and they need some time to recover. So
I appreciate that, Paris, but we need whatever intel we can get out of them right now.
This is the time to perfectly calculate.
Why right now? What's the emergency?
Without killing them.
We're like the ass end of space.
Did Denver actually make it back to the ship? And Denver, did you hack that?
Denver did. And he did successfully hack it. It wasn't that complicated. Denver, while you were walking back to the ship, you managed to listen to some crew members' story or like log about how now they're in the middle of nowhere on some planet, like dying, and it's all because like Willis couldn't like bury her enthusiasm for exploration.
Well, that's a touching tale.
It's like very, very disgruntled.
All right. I'm gonna knock Pittman out of the way, sit down, and put my palm print on it, unlock the console, and I ask the lieutenant commander, is everybody secured for takeoff? We're ready to leave.
Yeah, let's get out of here.
Yeah.
All right, we punch it.
So as you punch it into space, you come, within a few hundred miles of the generation ship.
Yeah, it's not there.
What?
Oh, so let's dock there.
No,
you don't have to dock there.
Nope.
I'm saying you pass it on your way out.
Yeah, but like, you know.
Nope.
Come on. Just stop by, see what's going on.
Lieutenant Glass wishes to disembark on the generation ship and pave the way for the navy that you're going to send here.
Say, Lieutenant Glass, if you want to stay here, you're more than welcome, but the rest of us are going home.
All right, Lieutenant Glass
puts on his spacesuit.
Lieutenant Glass like puts on his spacesuit quickly. Maneuvers right over to the huge hangar bay, jumps out and sets the autopilot, locking the console so that
this is like anathem space travel. No, so you end up as you maneuver around it and like to leave, the like Cerulean, he like walks up and he watches it intently as it like passes by on whatever the starboard side.
Hmm. We're like, thanks for your help today, buddy.
I want to stay behind.
So you make your way back to the bad side of town. you make your way back to the bad side of the planet where like there's like a meteor shower, and you notice in the distance to see that the gate itself is just being like bombarded by these asteroids. It seems like it took a few hits and now it's spinning a little bit faster and very like it kind of like does like a weird rotation as it keeps getting hit.
All right, I can do this.
Oh, great.
If anyone has some sort of like engineering check, then
I think
what kind of engineering? I have all the engineering.
I have a prehensile tail.
That's natural engineering.
I have
mechanical. Let's do mechanical.
5-2. Oh, okay.
To organize the troops.
Mechanical engineering is 7.
All right, so it's 2d10 plus 7.
And what am I doing exactly? I'm a little confused.
You're observing something with your keen technical eye.
Come on, Weiss. Help us out, or else you were no good.
Wow. So it looks like the ring is beginning very... you see in the distance that there are certain cracks that weren't there before. It seems like the ring is beginning to lose like structural integrity as, you know, it got hit by a few meteors in the past like hour or however long.
Get us home, Glass.
All right, I say, Lieutenant Commander, I park the ship for a second.
All right, kick Glass out of the pilot seat and fly my damn self.
I just want to state for the record that think anyone will be able to make it back here to this generational ship, and I wish
if we all die out here, then it doesn't matter.
Yes, but it would have been worth it. However, I'm going to save us all from
certain doom.
And I say, stand back. You're about to witness the miracle jet. And I sit down. Oh. I sit down back at the console.
I hope you fail so fast.
We all hope you fail.
I'm kind of hoping to.
Oh, no.
Come on, what else?
Right, the thing is spinning, right? Now. I make all these calculations. I adjust us to rotate at the same speed as the ring. Mm-hmm. I fly around. I jet right towards the aperture.
And here it goes.
Yeah, let's see it. All right, it's not so good.
All right, so he does a few like loops coming in to try to get right into the ring itself, and as he goes, you know, he maneuvers stuff from the underside and he goes right in through the top. And as he does, you know, the slipstream takes you, and you begin to lose the signal that's been kind of playing on repeat the entire time. You know, and as you essentially, as you come out the other side of the ring, due to very smooth piloting ability of Mr. Dorian, as you come out the other side, the already like the ring had a very like dull glow to it. As you come out the other side, within a few minutes, the dull glow kind of like disappears.
Sorry, just God damn it, Nick.
No.
You were saying, Alex?
I said that the dull glow of the ring disappears. Like there was a very like dull glow to it, and it seems to like completely fade away, and now it's just like a giant like metal structure.
Wow, you guys ruined all hope of that generational ship.
We killed Chris.
No, he's back.
Oh, okay. So you really screwed the pooch on this one, Lieutenant Glass.
I say, sir, I haven't screwed a pooch in quite a while.
Why?
So you hear that Ensign Prez, you hear Rose trying to like say something. She's like reaching out for your hand, and she's like trying to like mouth something.
I dive over to listen.
I want to point out that Paul L. said in chat, doctors make people better, medics only make people more comfortable while they die. Well, Ensign Prez, how do you feel about that?
Ensign Prez, Rose reaches for you, like, she's trying to get your attention.
Well, good thing I can hear whisper at 500 feet. Whatever she says, I will hear it.
Okay.
Listen carefully. My cat ears are ready to go.
She reaches for you, and she says, just two crew. She like takes another breath. She's like, two crew members.
They're right there next to her.
I show up and I say, I'll be one of your crew members.
I say, Glass, get the
fuck
out of here.
Fuck out, Glass. What do you mean, two crew? Two crew members.
She says, three surviving.
There are three surviving crew members.
Yeah, they're right next to you, dear.
There's you and these two here. There's more.
She turns in the position that she was facing. She couldn't see them, but she repositions it, looks at them, and she takes a relieved sigh.
No, we've got you, Captain. We've got you and your crew. You're gonna be just fine.
Probably.
But maybe, who knows? And then she goes, generation, and with a question mark.
We've noted it. we know that it's there. We saw it.
I wrote it down.
We're gonna see if we can't get back to it.
You'll have to explain that in your court martial
later.
Okay, so Dorian ends up successfully navigating out of the out of the asteroid belt and so on, and you end up going back to the dockyard where you started. During that time, the
dockyard on the metal, right? We're going back to our cruise.
We can at least finish the cruise.
Rose is feeling better and, able to sit up and talk and all that.
I take walks with her in the arboretum.
she slowly recovers, not 100%, but it does not look to be fatal. But whatever it is, hopefully can be cured by the doctors at the dockyard. And so she slowly begins to tell you the story about how they found this. They had their ship went through. They were going through this asteroid field where they started getting these weird signals, and they ended up finding the stream. And instead of they sent a radio signal back, but they weren't sure if it made it through. So they went in through it, but their pilot wasn't able to keep the ship under control, and they pretty much came out the other side completely damaged. And
amateur.
They landed where they could and sent a signal. There was 20 of them when they started, but 17 of them ended up dying, and only the three of them remaining. Two of them even chose to give up their breathers for the others to make it through. And so, you guys were the ones to intercept the first symbol, the first signal. So you get commendations on the successful missions.
A voucher to go back to the nettle.
Is that you? They're going to give them commendations after their court martials?
Yeah, just ask how many court martials are we talking about?
Guys, it seems to me
her court martial.
It seems to me the nettle needs some new owners and a new captain.
Yes, and a navigator. My God,
whatever. So on the news a few days later, you end up catching news about how the, you see Megan Mitchell, the security officer from the nettle, talking about
how in the back of the head. he died in a freak airlock accident.
How the captain was working with the hegemony to try to to kill some of the crew members. Their names are never mentioned, the people that died. That there was four murders on the ship.
Guys, I'm just glad those people who were murdered were never found out how incompetent their murderers were.
Yeah.
And so the captain is to stand trial with a group of Navy Marines to stand as witnesses, or Navy personnel to stand as witnesses.
Yeah, we will gladly testify.
Can I stand in the firing squad instead?
All right. Well, so that wraps it up. Thank you guys for playing. As a reminder, next Tuesday we are going to have Chris McCown join us for a little bit of a breakdown of the adventure itself and Fallen Stars. So join us if you want to ask some questions. Of course, all our players are going to be present. You can ask us questions and
right. Chat. Also, if anybody has any questions ahead of time, they want to send them to us on Twitter. They can send it to @livefrombeyond.
That's correct.
Alex will also be unveiling his competition game, Opposed D6.
That's right, Opposed D6. No, I'm not going to be doing that. So yeah. So thank you guys for watching. If you're watching us on Twitch, check us out on YouTube. If you're watching us on YouTube, check out our Twitch stream at 7:30 p.m. on Tuesdays. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye.